range of technical and other issues.
Thank you. So some of you maybe heard or know that we have a bit of an excitement around our holographic libraries that we ship here on product with awards and recently. And one of the outcomes of that are that some of the things that we've been actually thinking and playing with for a while needed to be accelerated. And so in this talk, I would. The thing that we wanted that we played with was basically see if we could provide some of the cryptographic capabilities using external libraries rather than small implementations of those algorithms. And in this talk, I would like to talk a little bit more about and give you an update of the changes that are associated with this switch and. Also, maybe try to talk a little bit more in more general terms about the whole experience and maybe compare various pros and cons of going one way or the other, because you might be in a similar situation as well as someday, and maybe having some points to think about when you're making the decision if you want to implement something in Smalltalk or rather use some external library might be useful in the decision process. So first, I wanted to give you a brief overview of how we even got there, why Visualworks does have the cryptographic library and all that. So the way it happened was that in one of our cyclic periods of expansion, we just decided to implement SSL. SSL stands for Secure Socket Layer. We knew something about sockets. You throw in a little bit of bitwiddling, and then you've got to have secure sockets, right? And how hard can it be? Well, it turned out that behind those three letters is a small platoon of other acronyms which are pretty much required prerequisites. So it was a little bit more work than we initially expected, but I think it was well worth it. The component, the way it all came about came in several stages. In the initial release, we had the basics of the protocol. That are set up around the RSA algorithm and DES encryption and a basic support for certificates with the X509 stuff, which are essentially you cannot do SSL without the X509 certificates. In the subsequent releases, we added support for the Diffie-Hellman key exchange and the DSA algorithm. And that again required further work on the SSL protocol, because depending on the algorithm, the protocol actually changes quite a bit, the handshake. We also added AES at that point, but that didn't really do us much good, because there are no cypher suites defined in SSL that actually use that algorithm, but it's a standard encryption algorithm and good to have anyway. So after that, we were pretty much done with the protocol itself. The next phase was focusing more attention on the certificate side, the X509 standard, because what we had initially was very, very rudimentary, read-only, just for certain types of certificates, so we needed to do a bit more work on that. And at the same time, it coincided with another project that we were working on, which was support for SNMP protocol. And that one is based on ASN1 as well, and so there are a lot of synergies that we could capitalize on there. So we improved the X509 quite a bit, and eventually got the ASN1 framework to the point where nowadays you can actually not just use certificates in Visualworks, you can actually generate them as well, and all that stuff if you needed to. And so eventually the whole purpose of this exercise was to enable implementations of various secure protocols like HTTPS and mail protocols over the secure circuit layer, HTTPS, SMTPS, POP3 over SSL, IMAP over SSL, all that stuff. So that's what actually has been in the product for a while now. But that's not all what I would call cryptography here. Cryptography specifically would be those remarks that deal with the actual encryption operations themselves. The SSLX file managers are also applications of cryptography, not cryptography itself. So, just a brief overview for those who are not all that familiar. The algorithms I would roughly split in three broad categories. There are hashes, and you've probably seen some of these acronyms as well. Hashes are algorithms that take arbitrary input and compute sort of a unique fingerprint for them. Then you have another class, which is what people consider encryption, or what we'd expect from encryption, which basically take an input and turn it into something inscrutable, and hopefully anyone who doesn't know the key associated with this encryption operation wouldn't be able to decipher. And obviously you want this algorithm to be reversible by someone who knows the key. And these algorithms are generally controlled by a so-called key, which needs to be kept secret because anyone who knows it can decrypt a encrypted stuff. And then there's a third class of algorithms, which are generally called public key algorithms. And that's the relationship between secret key and public key, where in these algorithms there isn't just one key, there are generally two keys. One is called public and one is called private. And the idea is that the private key remains private. You never ever share it with anyone, even with the party you communicate with. And the public key is something that anybody can know, you don't need to keep it secret. And these algorithms are used for various different purposes. It's not just encryption. Some of them can be used for encryption. Some of them can be used for so-called signing, which means basically if you have some chunk of data and you generate a signature, then somebody who knows the public key corresponding to the private key used to generate the signature can prove to himself that the signature was generated with that key and that it was generated for that chunk of data. So it provides both integrity protection and authentication of the source to a certain degree. And there are other problems involved, like key agreement and so on. There are all kinds of strange classes of algorithms in this category. So, let's look at the categories one by one, if I had the time. First, the hashes. So, you probably heard about MD5 algorithms. So the way you would use something like that, a naive API might look something like this. You take the algorithm, you feed it some data, and you want to get some result back. There are various things wrong about this sort of API. For one, all these algorithms operate in binary data, and so setting the API up for string is actually a bad idea because string is not binary. To make string binary, you need encode it first. And so it is actually much better to probably not even allow passing string into this API because you're going to just wait to pay for it later. But it turns out that in practice, it's usually not just hashing 5-character strings that people need to do. It's more often that they need to hash large amounts of data. And this sort of API would not be very suitable for something like that because you need to pass the entire thing to the algorithm at once. So in real life, what you would normally do is more something more like this. Here you are going to try to hash a file, in this case, the image file that this image comes from. So the way you read a large file is you have a buffer, you would instantiate the algorithm, you open the file, and then you loop over until you hit the end of the file, reading a chunk of the file into the buffer, then passing it over to the algorithm until you consume the entire file. Actually, it probably should be running it like this. And so if you run through the entire file in this manner, and at the end when you run down, you need to make a final call to the algorithm, which finishes the computation in some way, and eventually gives you should have actually started this piece of code before I started talking about it. I probably see why. And this is part of the point I'm trying to make here. When you profile this, you know, when you first implement it, you'll notice this pretty quickly. Then you start profiling, you weed out all the overhead, you know, avoiding large integer overflows, making sure you're not generating any garbage if at all possible, and all that stuff. And when you're finally done, you'll realize this is about as fast as it's going to get. So, in general, this speed is good for some purposes, you know, client-side things, but I mean, doing an SSL server with something like this is completely feasible. So we have a problem here. Of course, when I talk to our VM guys about this stuff, they have answers for them. You know, we need adaptive optimizations and things like that, but here we are, 2011, still running this fast. So we need at least a temporary solution there, if nothing else. I think it should have been done by about now. The file is about 55 megabytes or something like that, so nothing particularly impressive. Alright, I don't have that much time to wait for it, so let's just start this. And move on to the next slide, where we are going to use an external library instead. The code actually doesn't change much. The change here is this line. Generally, when you're calling an external library, depending on which library it is, there will be different algorithms supported. And so, of course, you could have a different class for each algorithm, but at some level, you have just a simple hash class, and you're telling it which algorithm to use as a parameter rather than the class. So that's one difference, not particularly interesting. The update of the hash function looks pretty much the same. There's a slight difference here, and that is important though, is that you notice that in the previous algorithm I was doing the final digest computation at the end after I read the file. Here I'm doing it earlier, and the reason is because I need to release the resources associated with the algorithm. Generally there will be a sizable amount of memory involved in the extra in the processing of it somewhere outside on the heap, so you will need to deal with that part and release the algorithm at the end, one way or another. You can make it read and do it automatically. This is about how fast it should take to hash that file. So quite a big difference there. So that's certainly one fairly good motivating case for at least looking at the external implementations. Another thing that I wanted to show in this here is that we've learned a lot over the time using these algorithms for various purposes, and I think we came up with an interesting way to make the code even simpler. This is again an equivalent code. It's just the same thing, and I think you would also like it better than the previous slide, as I do. The idea is here that these operations here are really sort of like a streaming approach to something, and so if we integrate it to an actual stream framework, the result can be easier to use. It's quite fancy, I think. So this is an example where the same sort of algorithm is implemented in the Xtreme framework that I talked about a few times already. So that's hashes. The story with ciphers is very, very similar, and the reason why performance in these classes of algorithms is important because the hashes and the symmetric key ciphers are the workhorses of any security. That's the stuff that needs to chew on every single byte of data flowing through it. And so that's where the importance, that's where the performance really matters. I think I'm just going to skip through this one because it's similar sort of deal. The algorithm is slightly different. The API changes aren't that dramatic well, this is actually an interesting point that I wanted to show them. One limiting factor why the small talk stuff is not as hot as the sea is this. In this sample here, all I'm trying to do is basically run for some megabytes of byte array and just read a byte and write it back in without even doing anything. That's something you will have to do if you want to do encryption, right? You need to read the input and you need to write the output. So if you run this, here we are going to try and chew through 100 megabytes of byte arrays. And you can see that we are doing it at a rate of roughly 22 megabytes per second. And you can JIT it, you know, somebody, you know, who's going to raise an objection that this is workspace code. If you JIT it, it actually doesn't get much faster. It's the same code in a method. And the JIT was already primed here. Depends on what sort of fluctuation is in there. But it's roughly 22 megabytes per second on this machine. Rather weak machine. I mean, this is a network, so on a normal desktop machine it would be a lot faster. But the point I'd like to make is that earlier I ran an OpenSSL performance benchmark on this machine as well for the RC4 algorithm, which is an encryption algorithm. And this thing is running at a pace of roughly 70 megabytes per second. Actually doing something, not just reading, writing, actually performing full encryption. So you see that with the encryption algorithms, we are immediately running into a hard ceiling there, that we can encrypt it faster than 20 megs, because we do need to read the input and we do need to write the output. So anyway, similar story with the symmetric ciphers as with the hashes. Here's a bit of a discussion about the API. The old API that we used to have actually on the ciphers is not very good, because that doesn't support streaming at all. We have just the encrypt method where you have to give it the entire input at once. There are various reasons why that I'm not going into, but that idea was not very good. So the external implementation that we have actually does support the streaming mode. It works a lot like the hashes, where you can feed it the input in chunks and it produces the output in chunks in some controlled way, and doesn't require having the whole thing in memory at once. And again, with the Extremes framework, it's all nicely wrapped up for you and much easier to use. So here we are encrypting some small message that I didn't initialize because I didn't run the previous examples. So here is the message and the key. And it still doesn't work. Oh, padding, never mind. Anyway, you get the point. It's a similar story as with the hashes. That's, I think, the key point to take here. So the final bit of the third class of algorithms were the public key algorithms. The things that we had in there before with something like this, we had a generator class to generate the keys. So this bit should generate 1024-bit RSA key. And the way you would use it, you would instantiate the algorithm, set the key on it. You would tell it, depending on the algorithm, you may need to instruct the algorithm which sort of hash function it should use to process the input before the actual act of signing, and then you can tell it to sign a message. So a signature would be potentially a lot larger than the input that you give, roughly the size of the key. And that's the signature for the message that I tried to encrypt it earlier. In the external, with the external approach, the API doesn't change that significantly. We again move away from the having a class for algorithm, and instead are taking a slightly different tack where the algorithm is driven by the key. The thing I didn't like about the previous approach is you would instantiate algorithm, and now you would have to think that, okay, if I want to sign, I need to give the algorithm the private key. If I want to verify signature, I have to give the algorithm the public key, and you would have to think about it. And it seems like a much better approach to put the API on the key itself, and that way you see immediately that private key only supports sign operation and not verify, and public key supports verify operation and not sign. So it's immediately obvious which one you need for what. So here with the external implementations, you would make instances of this private key. And again, there will be external resources associated with the class, so after you're done with the key, you have to release it. Also, the external libraries generally don't mix the hash function with the public key algorithm directly. You basically have to do the hashing upfront yourself, which makes sense. Because again, the input into a signing algorithm might be relatively large, so you may want to process it in chunks again and stream over it rather than having an API on the public key functions that require the full input. So here's an equivalent expression to the previous. It's large, it's 10 to the 24 bit key, so again, the result would be a roughly 10 to 24 bits in size. So that's roughly how things are changing by switching from the native implementation to the external one. And while there are of course benefits, worthwhile benefits to it, it's not just all pluses or all minuses story. So in this, I've got 10 more minutes. Yeah. So in these last slides, I would sort of like to talk a little bit about the positives and negatives of each. So if you're looking at native implementations, definitive plus is that by going through the exercise of actually implementing the algorithms gives you a lot more know-how than if you are just trying to grab a library. And I think that might be often a mistake where people choose to grab the library to avoid understanding the problem. They think about it as a quick solution to their problem. For one, it's not going to be that quick, and for us and the other, it's just understanding how it actually works is often important to using it properly, and it's extremely important, especially in the security area. So that definite plus on the side of the native implementation. The other very obvious benefit is that once it's small talk, it just runs on all our platforms the same way. It's there, you don't have to worry about how to deploy it or anything like that. That makes it a very, very good deployment solution. And it's automatically cross-platform and all that. Integration is easy, it's right there, it's easy to debug. If you start wrapping external libraries, you'll quickly find that the debugger that you end up using is not the Smalltalk one you're using. The negatives are, again, probably partly obvious, maybe worth reiterating. For one, since you are implementing the whole thing, you're stuck with the maintenance, right? So calling the external library gives you some of that for free, partly because that's not the whole thing. There's still your interface, and the interface can itself get quite complex. So it's not maintenance free, but it could possibly be smaller than actually implementing the whole thing yourself. The security issues that specifically for the cryptographic libraries, the research moves forward, various weaknesses of the algorithms are found, and you need to keep up with that. So that's another, I guess, similar class of things that you need to keep in mind when implementing something yourself. Sometimes speed may be an issue, which clearly is in this case. There are other considerations as well. For example, in the field of security and cryptography, certifications and things like that are often important. For a project for federal government, the government often requires for frameworks to be used to be certified in a certain way. And getting a Smalltalk implementation certified is going to be probably in this case impossible. I can't really imagine that it would pass the X140 certification. So that may be important for your projects, for your clients, so that's another sort of consideration to keep in mind. An external library can provide you other goods like cryptography, and often it's important to get some leverage from the hardware. And so an external library might be actually written, something that actually came with a device that you can buy to do cryptography for you a lot faster or in a more secure way or for whatever reason. And finally, other consideration might be legal issues around actually shipping the component that you implemented. Sorry. So let's look at the other side. As a calling external library. So potential positive could be maybe it's simpler to write the wrapper than to implement it. It's not always clear, it's not always true, but it could be. You get some of the maintenance and evolution for free, hopefully, assuming the library is maintained and all that. In this case, it's definitely a lot faster. There's definitely certified options out there, and there are hardware integrations available as well. But it's not just positives. One big problem is platform coverage. So Visual Works ships on or is supporting on roughly 13 platforms or something like that. What we do for the cryptographic stuff, we actually hook up to two different libraries. The one that we wrote originally was the OpenSSL with crypto, which is fairly, usually the default choice on most of the Unix platforms. Since installed by default, it should be relatively hassle-free to use it on your system as it comes out of the box these days. That wasn't the case 10 years ago or so, but it certainly is now. On Windows, on the other hand, I don't yet quite okay. On Windows, on the other hand, and we have a lot of Windows users asking them to install OpenSSL to use this stuff or use just HTTPS because it's underneath. Okay. That wouldn't be a very welcome solution. So on Windows, we integrate whatever comes with Windows, which in this case is the Bcrypt library. However, that's still not the same story. The Bcrypt library is something that came out with Windows Vista, and so it's available on that and anything later. But it's not available on anything earlier. So if you're still running Windows XP, that's not the answer, unfortunately. It's also often with external libraries much more difficult on the deployment side. So if it's something that ships with the operating system and is built in, we are very likely to find the library by default. But if it's third party or something, then you're getting on the usual problems of, how did it install, how your file system looked, is it in the usual place, on Linux, for example, which distribution it is, and so on. So the deployment situation is often more complicated than with the native one. Supporting the external library, and if you're shipping a solution that uses an external library, one way or another, you are pretty much liable for any support issues that come from your customers, even though they are caused potentially by the library underneath. But you will need to at least mediate any resolution, and it may be much more difficult for you to resolve the case for your customer I mentioned already the FFI issues. The brittleness can be also an issue, like, as I mentioned, if you have a problem. If you're debugging something with the external crypto, your image usually crashes, the image doesn't crash, generally the signals can be handled, but the only way to see what the heck's going on is to have to launch a CDebugger on your running image and dive into the actual library itself to figure out what's going on, so that, again, not something many of us are all that comfortable with, and it's something to consider. So, to summarize, if I was standing in front of another problem and had to decide if we should implement it ourselves or if we should call an external library, there are several things that I would try to take into account. One is how easy it The deployment situation is also very critical, right? You know, it's not enough that you can actually write the code and how you deploy it to your devices and things like that. That's part of the equation that you just can't ignore. But platform coverage, this can be interesting. So you may need to deal with several different kinds of libraries and several different platforms. So that's something that may be a problem or not. Another one that is actually, I didn't mention yet, but this issue is with our external crypto stuff, is that the different libraries can have different capabilities. So for example, Bcrypt supports different algorithms than the crypto does. So if you are moving from platform to platform, then your users need to be aware that, you know, if you pick a certain encryption algorithm, it may not be available on the other platform because on the other platform it's a different library. There were also other kinds of issues. For example, with the Bcrypt libraries, I find the DSA algorithm and the DWT exchange basically unusable. I talked to Microsoft support about this, and their response was basically, well, we wanted Bcrypt to be FIPS 140 compliant, which is federal standard for how the modules should be packaged and what functions should they provide and that sort of stuff. And so they basically set up the API so that it's actually impractical in many common situations. For example, to create a DSA public key, you need some parameters for the key, which normally aren't available, aren't transported over protocols. And so, you know, if I'm required to provide those parameters, I just cannot use this because I need to use public key of someone that I received company. If he doesn't give me those parameters, I really can't use this stuff. And these parameters are not really necessary to run the protocol. They may be useful for some sort of checks where you can convince yourself that the key is actually strong, but they are not used, they are not needed to actually perform the operations. So things like that may be an issue as well. There might be other constraints that you need to consider